Greetings, Audio Avengers. Welcome to the Marvelous TV Club, a podcast tackling our collective obsession with the latest releases from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And that means it's time to continue our preview of Falcon and the Winter Soldier. Every week, we analyze the newest chapter of the MCU from multiple angles you'll only find on this podcast. Our story cast is live, and Amanda Marcotte and Maeve Adams have a ton of amazing insights for you on the history of Captain America as a symbol in American culture, as well as some iconic buddy stories that Falcon and the Winter Soldier might draw on for inspiration. On Wednesday's PonderVision, Jesse Taylor and I are going to dive into all the wild questions we have about the Sokovia Accords, whether Marvel is making any progress on creating a more diverse and equitable MCU, and a lot more. This is our Charactercast, where we will preview Falcon and the Winter Soldier character by character. What are their best scenes? What traits make them who they are? Is Zemo cool or goofy? And is it okay to kiss your uncle? I'm your host, Marc Faletti. And to help me answer these monumental questions is my favorite judge of character, Kristine Kippins. Hi, Kristine.
Hey, I'm so ready to talk about incest. Let's do it.
It's complicated. We'll get into that. My excitement is that you, based on text messages I got last night, are the newest convert to the Ant-Man is kind of underrated camp.
Oh my God. Okay, so for some reason, Ant-Man is just one of those MCU movies that I haven't rewatched with an obsessive nature like I do many of the other films. Because I think, you know, kind of like WandaVision, it's very different from the others. But not in the Guardians of the Galaxy kind of way, you know, because it's still on planet Earth. You're still dealing with humans and human nature. And it's still very, very different from the other MCU movies. And of course, I rewatched it because Falcon makes an appearance and I wanted to watch all of the Falcon and Bucky / Winter Soldier movies before we started talking about the show. And oh my, I just forgot how funny and delightful this film is. I mean, Act 3 really did it for me, where I said, girl, you've been really, it's been a complete disservice to yourself. You should have been rewatching this movie quite a few times, because watching Act 3 from the perspective of Cassie was just the best thing ever.
Everything in her bedroom is totally original and super weird, and I'm very pleased that they got away with it. And in a lot of ways, maybe presages a little of the whole WandaVision take it into the weird place kind of a thing.
Exactly. I think that's why I was able to appreciate it more. In the past couple of days, because I've come off of WandaVision and it's so kooky and wacky and I loved every minute of it. So I'm in a space where I could definitely receive that kind of different MCU vibe and really dig it.
Well, I think we're going to get a more traditional MCU vibe from Falcon and the Winter Soldier, but
no,
I'm not
kidding.
Sad about it. I'm actually getting real, real pumped up about it. Where are you on that?
No, I'm ready. I'm very ready. I feel like I'm at episode 4 of WandaVision, where I'm just like, okay, I need the MCU shit to come back. Where is it? It's perfectly timed. Yeah, I'm ready for some action. There was hardly any action in WandaVision. It was all in the last episode, you know? Yeah. So I'm ready for some shoot 'em up Harry shit. You know what I mean? Like some regular old spy/soldier story. I'm totally in for it.
Yeah, me too. So we're going to talk about four of the main characters. Falcon, obviously. Winter Soldier, obviously. Sharon Carter and the whole kiss thing. And Baron Zemo. Hey everyone, you're going to hear me say Baron Zemo a couple times. That's because in the comics, Helmet Zemo is also a Baron, but probably not in the movies as far as we know. And I think my comics brain and movie brain had their wires crossed a little bit, so my apologies. And then we'll talk a little about Captain America and being Captain America, which is the shadow that kind of hangs over everything going on in Falcon and the Winter Soldier. How does that sound?
That sounds good to me. I'm ready.
Then let's begin with Falcon. The first question I have for you, Kristine, is what is your favorite MCU scene featuring Sam Wilson?
Oh, God, Mark, that's a really hard question.
I know. I love to rank things. This podcast is where I make life difficult for you by asking you to rank things you love.
Ugh. Okay, so I keep going around and round in circles trying to nail this one down. And it's hard because, again, there's so many great scenes, so many amazing one-liners. But I think I have to be a basic bitch and say that my favorite Sam scene is his very first one.
Me too. All right, you make the case. I have a really good second favorite that we'll talk about.
Okay.
I totally agree. Anyway, you make your case.
Okay, so in Winter Soldier, I think his very first scene tells us so much about who he is, and it sets up beautiful callbacks later for later films, right? So first of all, we see that he's not intimidated by Cap. He just keeps doing his laps around the mall and the tidal basin at his own pace. But then eventually, when he keeps hearing on your left a few times, he feels challenged to pick up the pace. So he's a little inspired by Cap. But eventually, he realizes his limitations. He works with the body he has. He keeps going, but he stops, right? He's out of breath and exhausted, lying on the ground while Cap walks in, fresh as a fucking daisy, to give him a little bit of grief, right? So I love that introduction that shows like his determination and his ability to run in Cap's shadow. But the callbacks to this scene are really emotional for me too. And you know I love it when my TV and my movies destroy me. So at the end of Winter Soldier, he's in Cap's room while Cap is unconscious after the Winter Soldier did a good number on him. And Cap wakes up, finds his new friend to his right, you know, keeping vigil at his bedside. And the first thing he says is, on your left. And in Endgame, when all is lost, and Cap thinks he's, you know, making his final stand. He's about to die. And we hear Sam over the radio on your left. And I'm just like, oh, this is so good.
Well, I'll tell you what really jumped out for me from that scene. It was the conversation about the bed.
Right.
What I love is that right as Cap is about to pull away, I think Sam recognizes something in him that he sees in a lot of the soldiers that he works with in the therapy groups and the PTSD groups that he leads. And he tries to make a personal connection with Cap to give Cap an opening to talk about something that he can clearly tell probably Cap doesn't have anybody else to talk to about. So what I loved about that was that it was an immediate window into this guy, Sam, as an empathic person.
Yes.
And he didn't make anything that they talked about there about Sam. He was trying to give Cap this chance to be a little vulnerable, which when was the last time probably anyone gave Cap that opportunity since he came back and had been through this whirlwind of the Avengers and everything else. So to me, it was, yes, he was incredibly funny. And he was also very humble in the sense that he just acknowledged, like, at a certain point, Captain America is this legit superhero. But of course, his whole, like, don't say it, don't you say it thing was just hilarious and incredible.
Yeah.
All that fun stuff, the fact that he just effortlessly, you know, tossed off Trouble Man as sort of like, I'm classically cool, but not trying too hard. It's a really tough needle to thread in a movie to have a character say something that doesn't seem too try hard about being cool or not cool. And the Trouble Man soundtrack is a great choice. But it, for me, it's 100% that bed conversation about it being too soft and trying to connect with Cap in a way that benefits Cap and opens some doors that maybe have been closed since he came back. So that's kind of what jumped out to me from that scene. The only other one that was a contender for me was the Civil War fight with Spider-Man fighting alongside Bucky.
Yes.
Because it also showed he was incredibly creative in combat. He was really funny, totally fearless, and he was connecting with Pete even as he was connecting. It was struggling to connect with Bucky. I felt like he and Spider-Man were having like a great rapport opposite each other. And Sam's ability, once again, to connect with literally anyone is, I think, an underrated quality that he possesses based on these scenes.
No, I agree 100%. I had to actually rewind the fight scene in Civil War when I did my little rewatch because it was so good. And the thing is, every time you watch the scene, you find something new. So I didn't notice, or maybe I forgot, but I never really realized that he took Red Wing and hit Tony in the face with it, which sent me. I just started laughing so hard. And the thing is, you're really not supposed to laugh that much during these big fight scenes. But Sam is just so delightful and comedic and is able to give you these amazing, hilarious lines in the middle of the fight. Yeah, like when he told Spidey, like, I don't know if you've fought much, but there usually isn't this much talking.
Great line. It's classic.
Shut
line.
Up,
and yet
kid.
Sam is always talking, so I kind of feel like I'm going to call a little bullshit on old Sam there. Because I'm like, man, you talk a lot, and it's great. It's what I'm here for.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of how obsessed the MCU is with drones. You know, Spider-Man having like a weird chest drone. I'm out on all the drone shit, except for Red Wing. For some reason, Red Wing is cool and passes the bar for me of like, you can be a drone in this show. I don't know.
Because he treats it like a pet.
Yeah, that's right. He's named it. That helps. And he makes other people call it by its name. That's always fun.
And thank it and talk to it and pet it. Yes.
Yeah. Let's talk about some strengths of Sam as a character. What jumps out at you?
Well, I think that you hit the nail on the head when you said that his introductory scene set him up to be an empathetic character. The fact that he's a PTSD specialist, I think, is absolutely critical right now. He's going to need to draw on those skills himself in dealing with the trauma of having been snapped and missing the last 5 years and coming back and then dealing with that big battle and everything that has to do with that. And all of a sudden, one of his best friends has aged by like another 70 years. It's a little wild to deal with. And the world just needs that type of skill set. Right now, everybody's dealing with it, dealing with the fact that they've been gone or they've come back and the people that they love, their whole world is just completely different now. And then people who were left behind and had to deal with that trauma and maybe a new trauma of everybody coming back. You know, I think you need those skills, and Sam hopefully has them in spades. So I think it sets him up to be a very strong central character for folks.
I'm also a fan of his optimism. I think Sam is always of the belief that it's going to work out or that things are going to go well or that they can do whatever impossible task they set themselves up for. And I think what's cool about that is it's clearly a choice for Sam because he's been through so much shit and he's seen so much difficulty that I think Sam has worked hard to project that optimism, not just for himself, but for other people, the people in his life, the people he works with in his therapy groups. It just feels like that optimism is a huge component of what he feels like a lot of people around him need, going back to his empathy. So that's one of the favorite things I notice about Sam as a character is when you're having a moment of doubt, Sam is the number one person you probably want on your side talking with you or working with you to solve the problem.
Yeah, and I think along with that, Sam doesn't hesitate.
Ooh,
he's very decisive. And I think that goes along with his optimism. Like, he just is very strong in his convictions. He knows what's right, very much like Cap. I think that's something that they bond over and is good because they're on the same side. If they weren't, then you'd have another Civil War situation on your hand. But the man does not hesitate. He didn't sit there for a very long time listening to Steve and Natasha go on and on about what's going on with Hydra and S.H.I.E.L.D. He just jumped right in and he's like, here's my resume, boo. Like, what we doing? Where we going? Let me give you some advice. And this is how we're going to do things. And that's just the way he is. And I, you know, that might be a weakness at times, you know, but I think that his convictions make him someone you can rely on. He's not going to change that much. He's not going to surprise you. You know where you stand with Sam.
Yeah, I think that's right. Well, let's talk about some weaknesses. There's no such thing as a good character who doesn't have some flaws. Right. Have you noticed any flaws in Sam Wilson?
So it's a question for me. So I think he might have blind faith in the former Captain America, in Steve Rogers. So to me, it seemed like he idolized Steve. And I wonder if he thinks he has to fill Steve's shoes. And if he does, he's setting himself up for failure. You know, he himself said, I do what he does, just slower, right? But that was when Cap was around. when Cap's there, no one expects you to be Cap. Because Cap's right there, right? But when you're running around with his shield, folks tend to put their Cap hopes and expectations on that guy.
Right.
And I just hope that in idolizing Steve Rogers, he doesn't try to become Steve Rogers, that he remains his own man. So that kind of blind faith in Steve, I'm wondering if that could be a potential weakness.
I think when you combine his optimism and some of the stuff you were talking about with his decisiveness, another way that comes out is in a way he consistently underestimates opponents. And, you know, whether it's Tic-Tac, right, a.k.a. Ant-Man, or even Spider-Man, or any of these situations where I feel like the downside of always believing you're going to come out on top is he might not necessarily always stop and reflect on the level of danger he might be facing, which admittedly, if he did that too often, would probably stop him in his tracks. But I just think there might be a situation where he's consistently maybe underestimating the folks he's up against. And I think we'll find out whether or not that's actually a quality of his in this series. That's just something I noticed might be a bit of a pattern for Sam to work on.
And I wonder if there's a fine line between optimism and believing everything is going to work out and arrogance.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, being arrogant is not something you ever want to hear someone call you, right? and in the clips that we get of the show, you know, I think about that scene of the two of them in the plane and, you know, Bucky's asking for the plan and Sam just jumps out the window, not out the window, out the damn door of the plane. And that feels like a moment of arrogance to me.
Yeah, yeah. No, I think that's right. So what kind of arc do you want to see from Sam?
I want to see him become more of a leader, own man. To me, he's been a joiner, a follower, and he has displayed hints of leadership, definitely. But I'm really looking forward to him being a titular character. But mostly what I want to see from him is him carving out his role in whatever government and military structure we've got going on post-snap,
it's
right?
It's a bit unclear.
Yeah. The world is a very different place from the last one he saw, Wakanda. And he distrusted the shit out of world governments back then.
Yep.
Have they become even more intrusive now? Hmm. You know, we've seen what it did to folks like Hayward in WandaVision. Are they all like that now? How does an Avenger who clearly wants to keep on avenging do so when he's branded around the world as an escaped war criminal with no respect for law or international bodies?
Jesus. Well, that's a concise and terrifying summary of the situation for Sam. You know, I'm hoping he shakes off a little of that competitiveness that comes with a bit of toxic masculinity, right?
Mm.
Because I enjoy a good buddy quip as much as anybody, but one thing as I've gotten older that doesn't do it for me as much is when it moves into sort of bullying or the inability to sort of let yourself come in second from time to time. And I know this because that's like my qualities, right? Like I have often struggled to shake those things off. And so when I see Bucky and Sam arguing in every single clip from the previews, I hope that we are going to get them to a place where not just in their relationship, but specifically for Sam, he's comfortable with the idea of letting go of that need to win every single encounter. You know, he sees Ant-Man and the first thing he says is it'll never happen again, right?
Right.
You know, I don't know. I think there's one quality of Sam that I think he needs to shake off, and it's that competitiveness with other dudes. I don't think he feels it all the time with everybody in any way, or he wouldn't be a great leader of his PTSD groups. It's mm-hmm. just that it comes out in these superhero situations. And I don't know, I kind of want to see him embrace a relationship with someone he doesn't automatically get along with super well, like Bucky, and maybe let go of the need to beat him at everything.
Okay, so I'm a Taurus, and I found all of that very hard to hear because we're very competitive people. We like to be right all the time. So I feel like that was almost an attack on me.
I'm attacking myself too. Like I said, for me, it's one of the things that I just think most dudes need to reckon with at some point is that like winning every conversation isn't, you know, him jumping out the plane to your point is kind of what I mean.
Yeah.
That's not a helpful way to handle the situation. That only creates more problems. It's only an escalator of further bad behavior response from Bucky, you know, it's just not a healthy way to always be. Sometimes, amazing. All the time, maybe not so much.
Yeah, no, I hear you. I'm also looking at this from the perspective as the audience member, and I'm like, but it's so entertaining.
I totally agree. And we don't have fun without conflict. So
I know. I love my Oscar and Felix. I think they're, you know, they're my MCU odd couple, and I love them. But yeah, no, I totally get it. I totally get it.
Yeah, we'll see how it goes. But let's talk about the other half of that odd couple then. Let's get into Bucky / the Winter Soldier. Talk to me about a favorite MCU scene you've got for Bucky.
Yeah, again, not surprising that the scene destroyed me. I think my favorite Bucky scene is when we get a hint that Bucky is still there inside of the Winter Soldier. And this might count as a Winter Soldier scene, but, you know, I don't care. So the Winter Soldier had just killed Jasper Sitwell. He shot Natasha, went toe-to-toe with Cap in the middle of D.C., and got in more punches on Steve than anyone in MCU history to that point, right? So he demonstrated that he's clearly Cap's equal. And he's in, I guess, their debriefing room, the Hydra debrief brain scramble room, and he's having a flashback of being on that train with Steve in, I guess it was in Germany, somewhere in Europe. You know, he's having flashbacks of his fall and Zola making him the Winter Soldier. And Alexander Pierce comes in for his mission report, and all the Winter Soldier can think about is Steve. And keeps saying, I knew him. And Pierce is going on about his contributions and asking questions, but the Winter Soldier is focused and he's like, but I knew him. And he's just clearly distraught and confused and miserable. And Pierce is just like, you know, wipe him and start all over again. He ain't got time for all this emotional shit. And there was just something about his meekness, his complicity in the torture that he was about to receive. He knew it was coming. That he definitely remembered. Mm-hmm. And he just sat there with glassy eyes and allowed them to put that mouth guard in his mouth. And my heart just broke for him. There was just something in that quiet moment that broke my heart for Bucky.
Yeah.
But yeah, so for some strange reason, that's my favorite scene.
Well, we don't share our notes with each other for this show. It's something I want our audience members to know, because once again, you've picked my first choice as well.
Oh!
I have, it's no question the brainwashing scene in Winter Soldier is it for me. And part of the reason why is because it's a masterclass in physical acting. Bucky barely talks in that scene, but you see his confusion, his concern, his doubt, his anxiety all written across his face over the course of that scene. It's essential to connecting with him because he barely talks, which we just mentioned. And it changes the entire experience of, you know, the Winter Soldier as this terrifying bad guy into this, I don't know, human mess. And then, of course, they torture him and it's all terrible. But I don't know. That scene just really stuck with me because, like you said, he's having these flashbacks. And I don't know, man, the actor Sebastian Stan just took it to another level with everything on his face across that entire scene. And the only other one I really thought about was the end of the line scene, also in Winter Soldier.
Yeah.
We get a flashback to Bucky and Steve together after the funeral of Steve's mother. Bucky knows, much like we talked about with Sam, Bucky knows what Steve needs to hear and connects with him and reminds him that he is the one rock in Steve's life.
Yeah.
And not every friend would do that in that moment. And or have the ability to like make that deep connection. Maeve and Amanda talked a lot in our story cast about how Bucky and Steve's friendship is something that is a true emotional intimacy that we don't always see from male characters in film or in comics or in anything. And that scene is the one that does it for me. It's great in First Avenger. You know, we see Bucky protecting his buddy and being, you know, being a good pal. But that scene is the one where you realize like these guys are connected for life at a fundamental level. And I don't know, that also is an emotional anchor for me over the course of the MCU, the I'm with you till the end of the line, pal. You know, it's just, it's great, man. It's a wonderful moment of Bucky's whole person.
I'm so glad you brought it up, because when I saw this scene again, I realized it was the Hawkeye speech that Wanda never got.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Mm-hmm. Right. When somebody is down, when they have no one, they've lost the one last person they're close with. You turn to them and you say, I am now your rock. What the fuck? You just blew my mind, Kristine.
Yeah, it hit me hard because all I was thinking about was that that Faletti piece theater that you did. And that too is my second favorite scene. So you and I are on the same page here today. This is a little surprising because I also thought that I had a little insecurity with my picks.
Oh, wow. Yeah, no, I actually thought it was hard. And one of the things that I think this exercise brought out to me was Sam and Bucky, like Wanda, actually lack a lot of great scenes. They actually don't have as much chance to shine as I guess I had imagined. Because when I thought about Bucky in particular, I was like, since he's been the Winter Soldier, he's mostly just grunting and running away from people. There's not a lot to draw on there. Sam gets to have a lot of fun. But the fact that my second choice was basically a quip-laden battle scene, I don't know. That's the point of these shows, though, is that we're going to take these two guys from that limited perspective that we've had on them and, I don't know, expand it a little, I hope.
No, they need deepening, for sure.
But based on what we have seen, Kristine, what do you think Bucky's strengths are?
Okay, I feel like, based on our conversation thus far, this response might be a little controversial, but...
Hit me.
To me, it took him a little while, but he might be okay with being the sidekick.
Yeah, okay.
And, you know, and I think that's a strength because he's a humble guy who could clearly handle himself. But he's also not intimidated by whoever he's paired with. He keeps them humble. You know, Bucky loved to talk about Cap putting newspapers in his shoes before he was Cap. You know, like he has no problem going toe-to-toe with whoever is carrying that shield because he's still sure of himself. I mean, Bucky, before the war, was a little cocky, you know, kind of high on himself. That scene with Peggy and Steve at the... I don't want to call it a VFW because I guess there wasn't a VFW back then. But, you know, wherever all of the soldiers were hanging out and Peggy comes in with her dress and Bucky's trying to flirt and she only has eyes for Steve. And he's like, I'm invisible. I'm invisible. Like, it was the first moment where he's had that kind of setback, you know? Mm-hmm. Even in the scene where we're talking about with Steve and Bucky after Steve's mom's funeral, Steve is a mess. And clearly a mess because now his entire nuclear family is gone and he doesn't have a lot of money. But Bucky is shined up, like his hair is slicked back. He's wearing this great suit, nice coat. And you just kind of think that, you know, Bucky up until that point hasn't really struggled much. Or if he has, he's gone through it with such amazing confidence that one might not even know that he's been struggling. You know, but I think over time, especially being a Howling Commando with Cap, it humbled the shit out of him. Yeah. Also being tortured will do that to you too, probably, right? You know, Zola was doing all types of experiments on him, so that probably did a little bit to him as well. But I think where he is now, that humility is actually a strength when you're surrounded by superheroes and that's your day-to-day.
I think that's a great call because everyone needs a glue guy. And if he could evolve into that, he definitely doesn't seem to want the spotlight. He's not the guy who ever wants to have to answer to the press or to the government for whatever the hell's going on. He probably doesn't even want to be at the center of the decision making. I think that's a great point. He's just somebody who's going to have your back, hopefully, and keep you humble. I love that idea. My feeling, maybe it's a very similar facet of the same gem, is just his loyalty, which we kind of hinted at in the end of the line scene. The thing you know about Bucky post-brainwashing and pre-brainwashing is that when he says he does what he says and he's not going anywhere, he's not going to flip on you for some reason. And even if you kind of ditch him, remember, Steve's the one who's kind of ditching him when they're dating the girls and all that stuff. And Bucky just, you know, he takes it. He's there for you when he needs you. Close backup for me was his knife skills. Those are basically amazing. Winter Soldier.
So good.
Good strength.
So good.
What about his weaknesses, Kristine? What do you think Bucky has as his flaws?
Well, listen, we don't know for sure if Shuri got all of those trigger words out of his head, but I feel like that's got to be a major weakness, that if somebody can list off a bunch of words in the right order, right, then all of a sudden your brain becomes unlocked and you become their tool for whatever it is that they need to have done, and you just comply. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's the first words out of his mouth, right? I'm ready to comply. It's terrifying. So yeah, that's one major weakness. I think there might be another weakness in Bucky, and I'll be very interested to see if the show explores this. But the Avengers split up because Cap chose Bucky over Iron Man, right? Over Tony. And because of that split, they weren't prepared to take on Thanos together during that first go around. And I'm wondering if Bucky has any guilt associated with that.
Yeah, I wonder about that too.
That's going to be a heavy weight and something that could be exploited.
That plays into my weakness for Bucky, because I think his problem is communication. And I understand it. He's been through a lot. He's struggling to connect with himself, much less other people, after 50 plus years of brainwashing. But not to go with another Faletti piece theater, but if he turns to Tony after that footage, can open up and say, I'm so incredibly sorry. This is haunting me every single day. Yeah. That's all I think about. Not just your parents, but everybody they forced me to kill. I would do anything. I know you can't forgive me, but I also don't know how to even forgive myself. And I can't even begin to tell you how sorry I am. If he had just said that instead of running away, which is what Bucky always does when somebody challenges him or tells him he's bad, I just think that's, he would have gotten a long way towards preventing the very problem you're talking about, which is creating this huge rift between these other two friends that literally threatened the fate of the planet. So not all of our friendships do wind up with those level of stakes, but I know that it's hard, and I understand why it's hard, and the character as developed, it all makes sense. It's just that it is a literal flaw of his that he can't, and related to that is his problem with patience. He just won't sit still or be patient about what, you know, might be in front of him and let somebody either go through something or lash out at him for a second. And he's just got a short fuse, and I don't know, it holds him back, I think.
Yeah, no, I agree. That makes a lot of sense.
So the arc I'm hoping for from Bucky, also related to toxic masculinity, is that I hope he talks more and shares more. So if I want Sam to shake off a little of the competitiveness, what I'm really looking for from Bucky is opening up and being more vulnerable and expressing that vulnerability, because it's no secret. Everyone can see it written all over him because Sebastian Stan is this amazing physical actor, like we talked about.
Yeah.
But he has to communicate and not just be annoyed with people, because when he is talking post Winter Soldier, he is often just being annoyed with someone. And unless it's Steve, his best buddy Steve, I don't know, man, he's got to figure out how to get past that and share feelings, and that's where I want to see him go.
Yeah, that's good. An end to toxic masculinity, please, because that, I feel like a lot of that is wrapped up in that, you know, that men aren't supposed to talk about their feelings. They're not supposed to open up. And Sam being, you know, a talk group, a talk therapy leader, you know, their unlikely pairing might end up being really good for Bucky if they allow themselves to stop teasing each other for 5 seconds.
Yeah, I hope so. I'm not asking this show to end toxic masculinity for all of us, but I hope that they take steps in directions that model not only the behavior that I would like to see from most dudes, including myself, but also for specifically their character development, just some progress would be really meaningful. Is there anything you're looking for from Bucky's arc?
Oh my God, I want Bucky to find peace.
Oh man, great call.
Does he even want to fight? You know, when T'Challa came to him with that vibranium arm in Infinity War, Bucky was not happy.
Yeah, you're right. He was like resigned to do it.
He did not want to see that thing. Maybe he'd rather be back in Wakanda farming, maybe find a partner and settle down. You know, has he had a moment to think about what the hell he wants in his life? So that's what I want for Bucky. You know, have all the fun and the hijinks in the world and, you know, risk your life every day with Sam. But at the end, I really want him to figure out what it is that he wants. Is this life even for him?
I love that. Let's talk about a potential third lead, Sharon Carter, who has been with us in Winter Soldier and Civil War. Have we seen enough from her to get a sense of who she is as a character?
I mean, I don't think so, but I'm a big fan of Emily Van Camp, you know, the actress who plays Sharon Carter. I really loved her in Revenge and Everwood, so I'm happy to get a little more screen time with her. And I think she's going to have to fill the Black Widow void, so best of luck to her filling those shoes.
Yeah, I'm with you. I don't think we've seen enough to get a sense of who she is, other than the fact that she backstabbed her aunt and stole her man.
Now, I feel like that might be a little bit of an overreach.
Okay.
A little bit. Because they had one kiss.
We need to talk about that kiss, Kristine.
Yes.
We need to
yes.
talk about that kiss with Steve. My first question is, what the fuck?
I have no response to that. It was, listen, watching that scene after having gone through all the other movies, especially Endgame. Yeah, pretty gross. Pretty gross. But here's the thing. Like, we're experiencing this with Steve, right? We're not experiencing this with future Steve, with future, like, old man Steve.
Okay.
So, like, yeah, I'm uncomfortable with this scene a little bit. But at the end of the day, I understand it. But Sharon, like, you knew that they had a special relationship. That's why you kept him away from your aunt. You never told your aunt that Steve is, you know, under your protection or whatever. You were spying on him and all of that stuff. That he literally lives down the hall from you. So she knew enough to keep that away from her aunt Peggy. But did she know that they were romantically involved? Did she think that they were best friends, like Cap and Black Widow? Like, did she know the extent of their relationship? To me, that's unclear. And also, I don't think that Aunt Peggy is her Aunt Peggy. I think Aunt Peggy might be her great Aunt Peggy.
I think that's right. Aunt Peggy is her great aunt. I totally agree with that,
yeah.
First of all. So in terms of weird incest levels, that I think maybe comes into play. But I think you're 100% right that the fact that she kept her that she had a relationship with Steve separate and secret from Peggy isn't a great sign, because she was clearly very attracted to him.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, this didn't happen in a vacuum. This happened right after Peggy's funeral, where Sharon, who was obviously close enough to her to give the literal fucking eulogy.
This is the worst part.
That's the part I can't get with. If this had happened at another time and place in the MCU, I wouldn't have as big of a concern about it. I understand that grief brings people together in strange ways, but that really troubles me. It's just the fact that what they were just doing was talking all about Peggy after the funeral and in the elevator scene that you're talking about, where she admits she hid all this shit from Peggy. I just think there's no way Peggy didn't convey the amount of love she had for Steve. Who was the picture on her desk in Endgame that we find out? It wasn't whoever she wound up marrying in this timeline, which, again, that's a whole other thing to unpack. It was a picture of Steve, young Steve, pre-super serum Steve. There's no way in hell Peggy didn't radiate the amount of love she had. And especially in her older age, when she was unfortunately afflicted with dementia, she probably talked very openly about a lot of that. And so Sharon kissing Steve, it's Steve Rogers. I would probably kiss Steve. It's not that. It's that the scene is played as though, well, we sure have been all waiting for this. And I'm just like, what? Like, we need to reckon with this. Like, you might want to be together, but you guys
have
some shit to sort out before that's just like a slam dunk. You know what I mean? I don't know.
Yeah.
So that's bothering me. Do you think Steve ever told Peggy, when he went back in time and lived his whole life, I did have a moment with your future grandniece?
Jesus Christ. I hope not. I mean, men do some dumb shit. That would be a really stupid thing to say. I'm just sorry. I'm just like imagining this conversation in my head and it's not going well. Like, listen, I'm all for being honest, but there are certain things where it's just like, you're being too honest here.
Right.
And I feel like that's that moment. Peggy doesn't need to know that.
No, I think that's right. And it's not like when he had that kiss with Sharon, he ever had any idea he would ever see Peggy again, obviously.
Right.
She was dead. There wasn't time travel because Tony didn't live in his weird cabin yet.
Right.
So I don't think he should have told her, nor did he tell her in my estimation. But there's always that question of, like, in this timeline world, if then Steve was around, presumably he was around when Sharon Carter was growing up, how did she not recognize old Uncle Steve when she meets Steve?
See, but is that how time travel works? I feel like if we're taking Endgame rules, mm-hmm. right? First of all, they don't make any sense themselves, because Banner went through the whole, like, time is, you know, Back to the Future rules are bullshit, right? Like, you don't go back in time and that changes your current situation. Like, all that does is give you a new present. So my thing is there an old Steve there? I mean, I guess because he showed up at the end of Endgame. But to me, I'm not even sure that Steve is running around that universe.
Yeah, I think the Endgame time rules suggest that this version of Sharon Carter never grew up with an Uncle Steve, because she didn't. And that when Steve went back in time, he created a new timeline with a slightly different Sharon Carter who did grow up with an Uncle Steve that he did not French kiss. Which is great, I guess. Because, see, that means that when he was, you know, being her uncle, he never had that thought. But then we get old Steve back in this timeline. Now, I could spin a whole tale for you about how I suspect we're going to learn that what Captain America was doing over all those decades was reckoning with a bunch of crazy time travel shit, because he created a separate multiverse timeline and probably awakened a whole bunch of other stuff just the way that WandaVision hinted was going on. And so he might actually literally be able to hop some of these timelines and came back over to this one to talk to his original buddy Sam and hand over the shield. But again, that's just a ton of speculation. And if I learned anything from WandaVision, it's don't overthink this shit.
Yeah.
So I'm just weirded out by the whole thing. And my last question on this is, how horrified was he when he met baby Sharon many, many, many years later? How weird would it have been to hold as a baby someone he had romantic feelings for like 30 years earlier, 40 years earlier?
Oh.
It's just, I mean, God. There's no right answer to that. It's okay. I don't know how you answer that question.
I answer that question by throwing up in my mouth a little bit, basically.
It's a tough look.
I mean, I'm just seeing Steve a little bit older, holding this baby and just like shaking his head ever so slightly, and hopefully just keeping all of that to himself.
Yeah.
Just keep that inside, Steve. Don't let anybody know.
We went from this character of wondering, like, had he ever had sex with anyone, to, oh my God, he's done something. At least it's just a little outside the norms, let's say, of socially acceptable romantic behavior. He got weird with it. And I guess I just will never understand why they treated that scene the way they did. It wasn't like Star Wars, where they then kind of maybe didn't fully know that they were brother and sister and how all that was going to work when they had the Luke and Leia kiss. These two Frenched after the funeral. They were just talking about it the whole time. I don't know. I'm never going to get over it.
Because Peggy could have still been a mentor to Sharon. You know?
She had to have been, or she wouldn't have been given the fucking eulogy.
No. But here's what I'm saying. This is what I'm trying to say, that they didn't have to make them related to one another.
No.
Like, Peggy could have just identified young Sharon as, you know, someone with potential, someone that she saw a little bit of herself in, and just been a mentor to her. And then Sharon could have just been at the funeral, you know, hey, I'm with the CIA now in Germany, so I just happened to hop over for my mentor's funeral. Peggy was so instrumental to me in my young career and blah, 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 blah. She didn't have to be her goddamn niece.
Yeah. And obviously they have the same last name. This is one of those things where the comics might have trapped them and they felt they had to have that relationship. But he could have even just said, hey, are you guys related? And she could have been like, distantly. I mean, they were the British side and I'm the American side. I think somewhere the family trees go back.
Right.
But it was never really clear. And so, yeah, to your point, she doesn't need to give that eulogy. I understand they needed a moment for Captain America to hear somebody tell him to be a tree.
Right.
Which I'm still pissed off about because I don't agree with that. But that could have just happened in that aftermath scene like you're talking about. They could have just had a moment, two people talking to each other. The Russos are amazing at those scenes.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I'll never understand all those choices. And I hope we get a lot more from Sharon in this show that makes me appreciate her as a character.
Agreed. agreed. She could definitely do with some broadening and deepening of her characters. She's no longer Agent 13, but like this fully formed person that we love or hate, love to hate, whatever, you know, just make her something.
One word answer question for you. Will they bring up the kiss in the show, yes or no?
I think it'd be really funny if they did.
I think
I hope they do.
I think yes. I think yes.
I mean, that's the one, the first moment where we saw Sam and Bucky have a moment together where they were on the same page and they were just like happy for their boy.
Which, again, Bucky knew Peggy very well. I don't.
Here's the thing. Did Bucky know about the family relation? Because Sam was at the funeral with Cap.
Right.
Bucky wasn't. I don't know if they had an opportunity. Like, Sam turned around and be like, you wouldn't believe this shit. The dude, the girl that we've been trying to, like, hook him up with this whole time turned out to be Peggy's niece. Like, I don't know.
He should have. Sam had a fucking obligation to tell Bucky.
Yeah, but he wasn't cool with Bucky like that. He probably loved the fact that he had this bit of information over Cap's original best friend, and he could just, like, keep it to himself. But yeah, but what was up with Sam? Sam nudged him and was like, yo, look who's up at the lectern. Like, he knew Sharon's significance. And then he knew about the relation to Peggy. But again, do you think Cap shared with him his romantic relationship with Peggy? Because, and the only reason why I ask this is because in Winter Soldier, he and Black Widow, who again, want to make clear, they're not best friends at this point. They are on their road to becoming best friends.
Right, right.
They're down in the original S.H.I.E.L.D. bunker where I see the fact that it's Zemo and Zola. I always get them confused because they're four-letter names that begin with Z and they're Cap's nemesis. But he's in Zola's brain or whatever. Oh, no, they're not even there yet. They're in the S.H.I.E.L.D. bunker. And it's where S.H.I.E.L.D. started, and they see the pictures of Peggy and Howard Stark and whoever Tommy Lee Jones plays in the original
Captain
America.
That general dude, yeah.
Yeah, that general dude who's just amazing, and I love him. And, you know, he's like, this is Howard. And then she's like, well, who's the broad? And Cap doesn't tell her. Cap doesn't say anything. So I wonder sometimes if he kept his relationship with Peggy a secret to folks.
Maybe. I mean, I think that's a really good textual case for it. I'll say this. It didn't take much for Sam to kind of understand why Steve didn't come back after they talked. And I don't know. It's a great question. I don't know. I'm fascinated by this, not just because of the blood relation, to be clear, but because Sharon and Peggy were so close. And right. I don't know. If I had 30 seconds with the Russos, that's the only thing I would ask him about. I wouldn't. That's the only thing I want
to
know. Not paintballing community, not their incredible efforts with Infinity War and Endgame. I just want to know what the fuck they think about all of this. That's what I want to know. Burning question for me.
The fuck were you thinking?
What the fuck? And maybe they have a great answer to that. And I think so many people want to hear that answer. I just need it. So
has no one asked them?
I don't know. I might have to go on a Google deep dive and report back. If I find out, we will continue this conversation.
Excellent. I look forward to it.
On a future character cast. All right, let's talk a little bit about Zemo. Is he a cool villain or is he a goofy villain?
Oh, he's so fucking cool. He's so fucking cool. I love a smart villain. He's not strong. He's not rich. He can't fly. There's absolutely nothing special about Helmet Zemo other than he's really determined. And I absolutely love that. It makes him real and accessible and therefore scary as hell. Like, this dude could exist in the real world. That's the type of villain that scares the shit out of me. The one that could be running around the Pentagon right now.
He has a coherent ideology, which is superheroes shouldn't exist, and is one that we can connect with, which is what makes a great villain. You've talked about that before. I also think his form of selflessness in that he's willing to sacrifice himself to achieve his goals, or even just after he's achieved his goals, and of course T'Challa stops him from doing that. But that's scary. That's what makes him scary, is that he does not have a high sense of self-preservation. So when he wants to pursue his ideology, it doesn't matter if he goes down with it. That is terrifying and I think makes him a cool villain.
He's got absolutely nothing to lose because everything he cared about was already taken from him. It's terrifying.
Sometimes we have to find new things to care about. I hope Zemo does some of that. Have you seen the picture of his purple mask?
His little Grimace mask? Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, Grimace is definitely a common comp. The other one I see all the time is Thanos. Do you think he's trying to intentionally evoke Thanos with his mask? Like, I've got purple stripey face and you should be terrified of me.
You're blowing my mind right now. Yes, 100%. Because this man, he's not strong. He doesn't fly. He's not rich. He doesn't have a whole bunch of resources. Like, what he is a psychological villain.
Mm-hmm.
So, of course, if he wants to mess with the Avengers, what better way to do it than triggering them with remnants of Thanos?
What do you think Zemo's role is going to be in this show? Do you think he's going to just be a big bad? Do you think he's going to have some arc himself? What do you think?
I kind of want him to stay a big bad. I don't know, because here's the thing. Can he even do the same shit he did in Civil War? You know, turn the Avengers against one another?
Are there even Avengers to turn? Who knows?
Right. Like, I just want him to stay sneaky and be this mental villain. I want him to be a disruptor and a saboteur. Like, that's what I want from Zemo. Oh, listen, and if I don't get it, that's perfectly fine as long as the story is good. But mm-hmm. I kind of, you know, that's kind of where I'm thinking his role will be. I mean, we only know of these four people in the show. One of them has to be an antagonist. So I'm kind of hoping that he stays that way. I don't necessarily want him to have a redeeming arc because I think he's just so good at being a villain.
Mm-hmm.
He's my kind of villain.
I'm with you. I think it'd be kind of fun to keep him in the bad guy scene, but I also think he has demonstrated enough of a coherent ideology that he might actually be able to be moved if he finds a greater superhero threat on the other side of the line. So say Sam and Bucky are dealing with somebody who is an even worse super-powered person. I could see Zemo getting on the same page with them and tackling these collective toxic masculinity issues together. That's what I'm talking about. We'll see about that. The last thing I want to talk to you about, Kristine, is Captain America and that shadow I mentioned hanging over the show. What does it mean to be Captain America in today's world?
Oof. I think because of the name, folks believe that Captain America stands for defending America and the American way, whatever the hell that means. Like an on-the-ground Superman, right? Yeah. But for me, I think Captain America has always stood for freedom. Freedom from tyranny, in particular. The man does not like a bully. And sometimes that means calling out your own government when it's being a bully. And this country is having a reckoning with its racist, white supremacist history and present-day structural inequities. So the government has been and remains a bully of Black, Indigenous, and other people of color, and poor people, both at home and abroad. I think a Captain America would stand up to that. And having a Captain America with the lived experience of facing racism and the inequities inherent in our societal systems should make the message all the more powerful.
You talked about how Sam trying to live up to all these specific Steve Rogers mythologies was something that could be a challenge for him. But what would it mean to have a Black Captain America?
I mean, it would mean quite a bit. Honestly, no one has contributed more to the global supremacy that is the United States than African Americans. Literally built this country from the bottom up, had their history and culture stolen from them, and had to create a new one. And then even that's appropriated at times and stolen from them. And have to do more with less and are held to these impossible standards. And even when they meet them, are given less than those that you know, have started at a much different place in life and a far easier place in life and get no celebration for it. I think having a Captain America that's black, if it's done well, is going to be a tough mirror for America to look into, to see someone who embodies the best of America, our determination, our exceptionalism, our willingness to stand up for what we believe is right, especially that of being free and having liberty. But seeing that in the face of someone who is among the most oppressed among us, I hope it's done well, because it's going to be really, really, really powerful. It's going to be tough for some people to digest. It's going to be glorious for some people to watch, because they'll connect to it and finally feel represented. I mean, listen, I remember what it was like opening night for Black Panther and the type of representation that I felt then. There's an actress in the movie from my parents' country. Like, she and I are both the children of Guyanese immigrants. So Shuri's character is played by a British Guyanese woman.
Letitia Wright.
Yeah. And it's very, very rare for me to be able to say, oh my God, look at this Guyanese person. You know, there's another West Indian in the film. You know, the man who plays M'Baku, Winston Duke, is Trinidadian. Like, that's a major thing and something that folks talked about for a really long time. And I remember seeing videos of young Black men seeing the promotionals for the movies in the movie theaters and hugging them and being like, oh my God, is this what it feels like for you white people all the time? This is amazing. You know, just like hugging these cardboard T'Challas and, you know, having all of this joy. So it's important. It's important for the people who are, you know, who have lived their lives in this system and feel so trodden upon. But it's also critically important for young kids who have really yet to face that, to know that it's possible to be a Black superhero. And not just that, but like to wear the stars and stripes and represent America. Wow, that was a little bit of a rant.
No, that's, I mean, incredibly well said. Let's hope they don't fuck this up. And if they do, we'll be here to talk about it.
We will call them out for sure. But yes, I'm going to remain positive. I'm going to tap into that Sam optimism and say that this is going to be good and this will be well done. Because quite honestly, Marvel hasn't let me down yet.
Well, where can people find more of these great insights from you, Kristine? Where can they follow you?
You can follow me on social media at Kippins K, and you could also listen to me rant about TV and movies on the I'ma Need More Wine podcast.
On that note, podcast powerhouses, that is our show for today. We have one more epic Falcon and the Winter Soldier preview coming your way on Wednesday, and then we will be back with Storycast to break down the themes and narrative devices of our first episode of the show on Saturday. So please leave us a 5-star review on Apple if you can, as it makes a huge difference with our visibility. And if you're on another platform, hey, just tell a friend to look up Marvelous TV Club on your podcast app of choice. Roll the credits, Tic Tac, because it'll never happen again.